Without any further ado, I'd like to introduce Jordana Davis and Kate Spaziani, who are going to give us a brief overview of the federal landscape. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon. Hopefully step one will work. Maybe not. How do I get the screen on? All right. So I think most of you, or we Kate and I know many of you, you know us, but we'll give you a brief intro to who we are. I've worked for Jeffrey for about 3 years now. Was in Washington for 5 years before that. I worked for Senator Russ Feingold and then for Senator Sheldon Whitehouse, mostly on the ACA. Kate worked in Washington for 12 years. She's been at Sachs now for about a year. And she worked for Ron Kind, Marion Barry, and most recently for Chairman of the Budget Committee, Kent Conrad, who also serves on the Finance Committee. So she has extensive experience with both the ACA and with deficit reduction. If you remember last year, speaking of deficit reduction, we started our presentation talking about a really fun topic, sequestration. You're lucky enough this year that there's a national election and you don't have to endure a presentation on sequestration. As Dennis mentioned, the election is gonna be an extraordinarily important one for the future of the ACA implementation, what parts remain, any parts that might get repealed. So we're gonna go over that quickly. Then Kate's gonna run through the lame duck agenda, which is all the provisions and the policies that need to be extended or that will expire at the end of the year and that need to be renewed, and we'll see how much of that Congress actually attends to. And then third, we're gonna go into ACA implementation that will go on at the end of this year and in 2013, and we're gonna transition right into a presentation from Ken Raske and Karen Heller, the Greater New York Hospital Association, on one of those provisions, the DSH cuts. So the election. We'll start with an overview of the House. As many of you remember, the Democrats lost many, many seats in the House in the midterms in 2010, and we ended with 193 for the Democrats and 242 for Republicans. This year, the projections show about 184 seats looking fairly solid for the Democrats, and many more, 229 looking fairly solid for Republicans. 22 is what is estimated now to be up for grabs. Quick math gets you 184 and 22 is 206, right? So we are very unlikely to see the Democrats taking control of the House again, barring any major events that would, you know, shift things before the election. In the Senate, obviously in 2008, Democrats gained a 60-seat veto-proof majority. They lost that down to 59, as we know, after the death of Senator Kennedy, and in 2010 went down to 53. This is 51 and 2 because 2 are independents, but they caucus with the Democrats. So they've been able to stop a lot of the sort of repeal efforts of the ACA that have gone on in the House and the Senate, but we'll see that in 2012, things don't look so sure. 47 fairly solid seats for the Democrats and 46 fairly solid seats for Republicans, leaving 7 up for grabs. So all we do know is that nobody will get a 60-vote majority. We're not really sure who's gonna get 50 votes. Things were, you know, looking probably a little bit worse for the Democrats before Congressman Aiken, I think, gave them that gift of a very unfortunate comment that has really turned the Missouri race and maybe other races. But so that's where we are in the Senate. The White House looks like this. This is the 2008 map. This is what happened when Obama ran against McCain and he won 365 electoral votes to 173. You'll see here that some really, you know, unsure states went blue: Colorado, Nevada, Wisconsin, Indiana, Ohio, North Carolina. These are states that are huge swing states, all went for Obama. Now we look at the projections for this year. These are pretty recent. These are last week, so nothing that was pulled today, but these are from the end of last week. 237 leaning pretty solidly for Obama and 206 for Romney. Remember, 270 is the number that you need to reach. So a lot of the states that we've seen, Nevada, Colorado, Ohio, Wisconsin, these are all looking yellow, but the truth is when you look at the polling in all of those states, every state polls towards Obama. So Nate Silver, who's the glorious nerd at the New York Times, who at least us nerds read every day, has all of these states polling within a 60 to 80% chance of going towards Obama. Nevada, Colorado, Wisconsin, Iowa, Ohio, Virginia all fit that stat. And if you look at the next slide, these are the chances that a particular state will actually determine the election so that any individual voter will cast a decisive vote. You know, it's nice, I guess, to live in New York, depending on what you think, but our votes don't really matter. So you've got Ohio is really the big state here. So that's why you always hear on the news, Romney was in Ohio today. You know, President Obama was in Ohio today. Virginia, Florida, Wisconsin. We hear a lot about Florida, but it's actually the third on this list, which I found a little bit surprising. Wisconsin, Colorado, Nevada, Iowa. Again, every one of these states is polling towards Obama. So what matters? This is really what Dennis was talking about earlier. If Obama wins a second term and the Democrats retain the Senate, then you'll see the same, very likely to see the same setup we have now. You're very unlikely to see major changes to the ACA. If Republicans are able to capture the White House and they are able to gain control of the Senate and retain control of the House, then you could very well see pieces of what I would think of as the Ryan plan, because I'm not sure exactly what the Romney plan is, but you'd see the Ryan plan a lot in maybe Medicaid block grants, Medicare premium support changes, other policies that were included in his budget. And you'd see budget reconciliation being used as a tool in the Senate if there's a majority of fewer than 60. So budget reconciliation is what is used in the Senate. It's what passed health reform. When you don't have 60 votes, you can do that. Divided power is what we expect to be the case. So we expect, you know, that not Republicans nor Democrats will control both houses and the White House. So I want to mention the governor races fairly quickly here, but just because so much we know ACA implementation hinges on the decisions of state legislatures and governorships. So we have 29 Republican governors right now, 20 Democrats, one independent, and 11 states are going to, are going to hold gubernatorial elections. These are states that are all very much swing states in the election as well. And this is the map. You can sort of ignore Wisconsin on this map. That's on there because they had a recall election that Scott Walker won, actually by more votes than he won his original election. But these are all states that are, you know, some of them are, you know, big swing states. Missouri, North Carolina, Wisconsin's out of that, Indiana. These are states, 7 of 11 of which currently have Democrats as governors. So if you see a major change here, that would really shift things in terms of ACA implementation. So now we're going to move on to the lame duck agenda, which Kate is actually going to present. And these are all the issues that Congress is going to face after we get past the election.
Hello. Okay, so now we're going to get into some of the nitty-gritty, but I will... We'll try to keep it entertaining and will not bore you. So the first issue that we're going to talk about today are Medicare physician payments. And as everyone in this room knows, we have been engaged in a never-ending battle with the SGR formula, the sustainable growth rate. And this has been a volume control measure that gets applied to Medicare physician payments and has resulted in cuts over the past, 8 years. And every year, every time a cut comes up, Congress acts to delay the cuts. And in effect, or in so doing, Congress keeps digging the budgetary holes. The cost of fixing SGR keeps getting bigger and bigger. And now we're at a point where actually repealing it and not even paying physicians more over a 10-year period will cost over $273 billion, billion with a B. So where we are right now is, again, our most recent patch takes us through December 31st of this year. If Congress doesn't act by that time, physician payment rates will be cut by 27%. So given our history on this, we know Congress is not going to let these cuts take effect, but there are a few implications that will impact everyone in this room. First, the cost of just a one-year freeze is $18.5 billion over 10 years. Congress has not been willing to, deficit spend to fix the SGR patch, so they've been looking for healthcare offsets in other areas to pay for this every time they do it. which means, again, at the end of this year, it's likely that the SGR patch will be paid for with something else in healthcare. And likely candidates that have popped up in recent history include hospital outpatient reimbursement and other areas of Medicare reimbursement. Just sort of an FYI for you to know about, MedPAC, the nonpartisan commission that advises Congress on Medicare reimbursement, has actually said the way that a permanent fix should be legislated is by not just completely digging physicians out of the hole, but cutting specialty payments or payments for specialists and freezing primary care payments, and then having all other providers take cuts as well to pay for it. So there kind of are no good options on this issue at this point. And this, again, is something that has to be dealt with by December 31st. So the next topic is sequestration. And we'll not go too far into this because we spent last year, we spent quite a bit of time on it. But as you all know, Congress last year, when dealing with the debt ceiling, came up with an agreement that was included in the Budget Control Act. And this was driven by the fact that House Republicans did not want to extend the debt ceiling without coming up with other cuts to the budget. And throughout the course of last year, sort of where we ended up with is automatic spending cuts that will total $1.2 trillion over 10 years. And these automatic cuts will start in January of 2013. The cuts will be about $109 billion for every year for 9 years. And the reason that 109 times 9 years does not equal $1.2 trillion is that the BCA will allocate savings towards savings and interest that we would pay on the national debt. So that's a little arithmetic there. Just a couple notes, some things that have been going on sequestration, which you may have heard about, but I think it's interesting just for purposes of timing. There have been two pieces of guidance that have come out of this administration on sequestration. And the, you know, one was an OMB memo that just said, we still have to wait for 2013 appropriations to happen before we know the exact size of the cuts to discretionary programs. The other one was a letter or a memo that came out of the Department of Labor, and it actually had to do with an issue that doesn't really impact the healthcare community, but in it, the Department of Labor talked about how this is going to work and what's the timing of sequestration. And the memo was interesting because it referenced the underlying statute, which said that agencies and departments actually have 120 days to implement the sequester order. So even though sequestration is supposed to take effect January 1st, 2013, and that tees it up as a lame duck issue, the cuts themselves might not start on January 1st. Agencies actually have 120 days to implement them. And the debt ceiling. So a year ago or so, we had just gone through this debacle where the United States credit rating was downgraded after Congress and the White House hit a stalemate over increasing the debt ceiling. And I think you all in the room probably know about it by now, but the debt ceiling is a limit on the amount of money that the United States Treasury can borrow at any time. So last year, again, during the Budget Control Act that created sequestration, the debt ceiling was raised to $16.394 trillion. So that is how much money the United States is permitted to borrow presently under current law. And just some other context for you. Right now, our government borrows about at a rate of $100 billion or $125 billion every month. And we actually are just $417 billion away from the current debt ceiling. So that means we're 4 months away from another debt ceiling showdown. And as we've noted here, the Republican House Speaker John Boehner has publicly stated that he will not allow an increase in the debt ceiling to move through the House unless an equivalent amount of savings can be found elsewhere in the budget. One other point to note is that after the Budget Control Act and sequestration of last year, discretionary spending levels are at the lowest percentage of GDP that they've been, you know, probably in 50 or 60 years. So, you know, discretionary is kind of getting tapped out. And if the debt ceiling standoff results in another requirement to find savings somewhere, you know, I think it's a pretty safe bet that entitlement spending is going to be on the table. Now, Democrats have been equally vocal about not wanting these savings or savings through a later deficit reduction process to come from spending or entitlement spending alone. And they've been arguing that tax revenue should be in the mix. So, unfortunately for Democrats and actually for everyone in the room, the Bush tax cuts are going to be expiring, and without congressional action, a lot of policy that is currently in place on individual rates and on certain credits and deductions will revert to levels from, you know, in the Clinton administration years. Because these are written in a way where they're going to expire no matter unless Congress acts, in order to extend them, it's going to cost money under federal budget rules. And the actual cost of extending the policies is $5.4 trillion over 10 years. In addition, as some of you might know, President Obama and Congress passed a payroll tax cut in response to the recession, and that's also expiring at year end. And in order to extend it at all, it'll cost $225.7 billion over the next 2 years. So we have all these issues, and we have a December 31st deadline for a number of them, and yet, as we stand here today, and we're gonna hear from a panel of congressional staffers, and we're gonna ask this question of them as well, but most people actually think that not much is gonna get done this year in a post-election lame duck session of Congress. So even though we know we have a debt ceiling limit that we're gonna reach probably in December, and physicians will get cut by, you know, 27%, starting January 1st, the payroll tax cuts will expire, the Bush tax cuts will expire. CBO has said it, with all of these things happening, and if Congress doesn't act, it'll likely push the country back into another recession. And yet we're, you know, 4 months away and we still have no idea what Congress and the White House are going to do. So we're going to have, like I said, a congressional staff panel who's going to speak shortly. Oh, and one more thing, appropriations. So we could have a government shutdown sometime over the next, you know, 6 or 7 months, too. But I think it'll be an interesting time to hear from our congressional speakers to see what they anticipate and to see from their perspectives what are must-do items. So, and on that cheery note, I'm going to turn it back over to Jordana.
Stole my line. I was going to say on that cheery note, it was just so cheery. So a quick run back to ACA implementation. Exchanges are going to be the big discussion. Okay, thanks. Exchanges are going to be the big discussion over the next few months because any state that wants to implement an exchange by 2014 has to submit a blueprint to HHS by November 16th, which is quite soon, 2 months away, right after the election. So these orange states are the states that are studying options. The yellow states are the ones that have said, we don't want to do it at all. Those light blue ones are sort of paving the way for a partnership. The darker blue are the medium blue ones are have established a state exchange. That's the California ones out there. And then the dark blue are the no significant activity states. So the big thing that states are doing now, particularly those who are moving forward, is trying to figure out the plan that they're going to use as the benchmark for what is going to be sold in the exchange. So the big thing that the ACA did and the reason that people tout the exchanges as a good new marketplace as opposed to the old individual market is that it creates uniformity in the plans that are offered. So when I'm a consumer and I go to the exchange, I know exactly what I'm getting. Why? Because the ACA laid out something called essential health benefits. And it's 10 categories of services that are going to be delivered by plans in the exchange. So this is your regular categories of things, ambulatory, emergency, hospitalization, mental health, drugs, labs, things like that. But then states also have to choose a benchmark plan. It's a plan that's in their state that's going to be actuarially equivalent, so not a mirror image, but actuarially equivalent to a plan that's going to be sold on the exchange. And HHS, in guidance, it wasn't a rule. Some people are upset over that because it wasn't completely transparent, but they put out guidance and it said, you as state can choose one of these four things as your benchmark. One of the three largest small group plans, one of the three largest state employee plans, one of the three largest federal employee plans, or the largest HMO plan. If you don't choose a plan, the default benchmark is a small group plan, and that seems to be what most states are choosing anyway. I think California actually chose the Kaiser small group HMO. So that's where we are on essential health benefits. That's going to be a really big thing as we move on here. The Medicaid expansion is obviously going to be a huge issue as well. With the Supreme Court decision, we know that states now don't have to implement the Medicaid expansion. It would have covered another 16 million people. It now won't. There's no deadline for states to inform the federal government if they're going to do the expansion or not. And we also now know recently that states can do the Medicaid expansion and then later choose to drop the coverage. So to me, if I'm a governor, and I guess I don't have any kind of major political message I'm trying to send, I don't know why you don't just do this while it's cheap, and then when it's not as cheap in the out years, you just drop it, but that's obviously an option for anybody who's sort of a policy pragmatist. CBO estimates that about 6 million fewer people are now going to get coverage because of the Medicaid expansion. But as it turns out, although there was a lot of rumbling, this was really going to increase the cost of the bill because we know that Medicaid is cheaper than putting people into private plans. It's actually not, because a lot of the people who would have been able to get Medicaid coverage are not actually going to get coverage in the exchanges, and so it's pretty cheap when you don't cover people. So some Republican governors have said that they may not or they will not, and that's Florida, Georgia, Texas, New Jersey, a little bit of an outlier, but that's Chris Christie, and Iowa. So the last slide, actually I should wait here and see if there's any questions before we go to the last one. Any questions on anything we've talked about? All right. So this last slide is just kind of a laundry list of some of the provisions that are going to take effect in 2013. Value-based purchasing, Medicaid payments are going to increase for primary care for 2 years, phase-in of subsidies for brand-name drugs in the donut hole, a medical device tax, the hospital insurance tax increases, FSA limits are going to change, and we're going to have an increased threshold for itemized deductions for medical expenses. The last one that's not on here, because it's going to lead into our next presentation by Ken Raske and Karen Heller from Greater New York, are the disproportionate share hospital cuts that will take effect or are planned to take effect in about a year. And this is tens of billions of dollars in cuts. Obviously, you all know this issue well, to many hospitals around the country who treat some of the most vulnerable populations. And the idea, obviously, is that if the insurance percentages increase, that hospitals would have fewer free care visits and that kind of thing, but we know that there are many reasons why that isn't necessarily the case for many hospitals. So I'll welcome up Ken and Karen to give that presentation now.